my black people. It's all about the unity. There's nothing they can do with us, so ain't nobody moving.
Warning. Stand by for countdown. Prepare audience for maximum impact. Full immersion begins in.
It's your turn. Just keep it going.
To try to suppress our determination to achieve liberation. Like Angela Davis said, it's built into the system.
Nowadays I can't believe what's going on in front of me. I don't want to watch TV and find another casualty. I don't want to read the news. My heart's already black and blue. I'm putting on my combat boots. 'Cause I got an attitude. We're like soldiers forced to fight a war. What the hell? I can't take it anymore. 'Cause for so long we've been patient, now we're done. And don't you even ask me when did I become such an angry black woman. In the air, we keep praying for a miracle. 'Cause every day is a struggle. But as long as my brothers and my sisters are in trouble, goddamn, I'm a ABW.
We can't successfully put an end to racial discrimination until we change the entire system.
We've been trying to keep the peace 50 years since Martin King. Some don't like me for who I am, but I love my melanin. Another future college grad. Like soldiers forced to fight a war. What the hell? I can't take it anymore. 'Cause for so long we've been patient, now we're done.
It's not right. Just keep it going.
They see something that I don't see. What can you learn from a bum, Omar? Shamsuddin? What I learned from a bum, maybe it's what not to do.
Nobody takes down. down Angel Snuffing Up 7 easy. There's a reason why, after 100 channels destroyed, Angel Snuffing Up 7 is still here. There's a reason why nobody want to get in a beef with Angel Snuffing Up 7. But you don't take me seriously.
This is a story about control. My control. Control of what I say and control of what I do. And this time I'm gonna do it my way. I hope you enjoy this as much as I do. Are we ready? I am. 'Cause it's all about control. And I've got lots of it.
Love and I've learned I've learned
a heart is a house.
You got to feel it.
Peace forever and always. Welcome to another edition of what we call the Realities Temple on Earth Internet Ministry. I'm the host, gatekeeper of this program, known here on social media, wherever you may find me. Welcome to a late night spontaneous broadcast of the Realities Temple on Earth. I'm Angel Snub Number 7. If you have not heard by now, the breaking news in the social media How could you say that? Out here on social media, especially in the black conscious community, all this blackity black stuff. Today, I heard that Brother Polite, many have heard of him, Brother Polite, officially put on record a plea deal that he accepted. And he did plead guilty to the charges that was against him, which basically was the rape and the sodomy of a 14-year-old girl. And in that plea deal, he is to serve 7 years in Florida State Prison, 10 years probation, also to pay retribution to the victims and have no contact with the victims once he's released. Those of us who have gone through the criminal justice system, we know that. We know how that goes.
Now you make sure you stay away from the victim guy.
And believe me, that victim, as soon as they see you hanging around, they will call. You can believe that. Matter of fact, a lot of people who don't like you and know your situation, they will call. They'll call the police. I saw Snup Nup 7. You don't have nothing to do with the case. I saw Snup Nup 7. He's been around, hanging around the victim. We love to get each other in trouble. I don't know what to say about us. This Negro. I was told that Negro is another word for dead. We dead as hell. But also at the same time, in this particular case, you would be doing a great service and in your civic duty, because indeed, I heard Polite out of his own mouth, I am guilty. And the sad thing about it, there are those, instead of keeping your mouth shut, ran to that man's defense. You don't know him personally. The only thing you know is his teachings and how he run his mouth. You don't know that man personally. And for me, or anybody that got or have any type of sense, you hope that these things aren't true. But you need to keep your mouth shut, because now all these folks look stupid because out of his own mouth, he has decided not to go to trial, because if you go to trial, you're going to get it if you lose. And he knows that the deck is stacked against him. He knows that he's guilty. So let me try to get less out of it. So his attorneys pled and got him a deal 7 years. I want to say this to us. A lot of men, a lot of boys, well, a lot of men have looked upon me as I developed into my manhood as strange. Why would you look up to me as strange? Not strange like gay. Not that kind of way. But strange in why do you really feel the way that you do about women the way that you do? There was a lot of factors that happened to me that caused me to develop into who and what I am and how I look at not only the black woman, soul sisters, but as women in general. I was the only male for years in my household. My sisters and my mother. And I viewed the woman or the women in my life, I saw them as a stronger figure than the males. You would think myself being a male, a young boy, you think I would be more attracted to the men in my environment, but I was not. I just didn't feel it. The women were more outgoing. They always held a job. They sounded smarter. I just was attracted to the women in my family. A lot of the men in my family, they were drunks or they abused women. One of the things that helped me in my development, besides that, because I was surrounded by womanhood and felt comfortable around women, my mother allowed me just to just experiment life, because there was no males. So everything about malehood, manhood, I had to learn through trial and error. There was no man to teach me nothing. And I'm glad, because most of these men were corrupt. They weren't full functioning men. They were really detrimental to womanhood. The ones around me, I can't say everybody, but I'm very sure there was many, many good men around. There was no male to pressure me or teach me about some sex crap. I was about 11 years old, and I didn't even know what sex was. And I was happy. I didn't care. I'm glad I didn't know. I wasn't missing nothing. Because since I didn't know, I saw women and girls not as sexual objects. I saw them as human beings just like me, which many young boys are pressured by even their fathers. This thing about sowing your oats and jumping from one girl, one woman to the next. So I'm coming up and I see womanhood as my equal. I don't see womanhood as the male is the head of the household, because the female in my household was always the one in charge. And who cared, because she did a very good job. Kept food in my mouth, protected me, wiped my backside when I couldn't wipe my backside, made sure I went to school. That's what she done. And when I was growing up, different from some of these idiots now, one thing you didn't do was talk about mama. I don't care what mama was. I don't care how fat mama was. I don't care if she was a drunk. We didn't care about what your mama was. Don't talk about my mama. But we do that and laugh and have fun, even to the point that women and girls now refer to themselves as bitches and whores. We refer to ourselves as the N-word with no help. We do it on our own. We've been called the N-word for so long, now we do it voluntarily. We use these racist words voluntarily. And we've called women and girls the hoes and the B words so much that they do it now voluntarily. This is a sickness. And the scriptures say, as a man or as a woman, as you think, so are you. So you become the B. You become the nigga. And this has become a problem to us because we have adapted and we have become the scum that we said we wasn't, but we've been called these things for so long, we become that. You can take a child and tell that child, you ain't nothing. You ain't never gonna be nothing. And then the child begins to believe they are nothing. And they stop trying. And they end up in the criminal justice system, or they end up in the morgue. They end up hurting somebody because I'm nothing. So if I'm nothing, you ain't nothing. So I'll blow your brains out. And I don't have no conscience because if I'm nothing, you ain't nothing to eat. You nothing too. So what? So we live in a very sick time. Extreme sickness. And those who claim they're supposed to help us heal, they just as sick as the person who they're supposed to be trying to help. They use the N word and the B words and all the derogatory stuff. They just as sick as we are. And that's why we have a situation like a Brother Polite. Brother Polite is not the first, and he won't be the last. A woman, according to y'all logic, or according to nature, as y'all say, that the man is supposed to protect the woman. But we have failed. We have become her predator instead of her protector. More of a predator than a protector. There's no real man that want to see his woman being a prostitute. There's no real men want to see their woman in some strip club half naked or naked and people throwing dollar bills between the crack of her butt cheeks. No man is going to tolerate that. But we do. That's her choice. That's not, yeah, that's her choice because she has to survive. But if you was a man, she have a different choice because you'll give her a different choice. But you're not a man. Ain't my daughter. Every woman, every girl in your community is your family. Ain't my daughter. Well, then you are a liar. Then there is no black community. For real. You should not want to see no man's daughter stripping on a pole, selling her body on the street. She should not be in that position. All our women and girls should be protected. But she has no man. She only has sperm donors and baby daddies and
things of this nature. She has no warrior. She has no god. She's just out here. So any predator can eat her up. Anybody, any predator. Even before she can come out the womb, these predators are ready to eat her up. A lot of it is influenced by religious teaching, because we know that in Islam, the Prophet Muhammad married a 60-year-old Aisha. I believe that's what her name, Aisha, something to that effect. He married her and then started having sexual relations, they say, at 13. It's a child. I don't know how old Prophet Muhammad was. I think they said he was in his 50s or something like that. I'm not sure. But she's a baby. What do it look like you, a 56, a 30, a 60-year-old? You gonna marry it? And it's happening in Africa. They practice that kind of stuff in Africa. Before the baby, the little girl can even barely walk, she's sold off as a wife to somebody. And she don't even know she's alive yet. And then by the time she's 13, she's married to an old ass man. Because he got some money. And a lot of this is religious based, because the men make up the religion. It didn't come from no God. So they put that together to benefit them. There is no benefit to the woman. So the few real men, and they call us divine masculine, women gravitate towards. Because all my life, I've always been surrounded by a lot of women. Because they feel comfortable. Because I'm not around them talking about, ooh, baby, your boobs is all big in your butt or whatever. I joke with the sisters. But I don't make it sexual like that. We just joke around because we grown folks. I'm not with that. I want to talk to your mind. I want to talk to your humanity. I want to know you as your humanity, not what kind of panties you wearing. And these our women, these young girls, the predators are already waiting to get a hold of them. And we talk about this on our platform. Our girls in the world of black consciousness in Africa and all this other nonsense, in that world, you as a woman, you don't even have a life. You got these predators ready to take your virginity as soon as possible, so you can spit out all these babies for whatever purpose. I don't know what the purpose is. Spit the babies out. And put you to work in the house, because I'm the man. Serve me. You ain't nothing but a slave. These young girls don't have an opportunity to live your life. You got years and years to raise babies. You got years and years to spread your legs for some kind of man and go, ooh, ah, ooh, that feel good. And, you know, I'm doing my womanly service for my husband and all this other crap. Some women don't even want the damn sex. Oh, well, he ready. I'm the wife. I got to lay down here. You just lay down and this sucker get on top of you. You don't even want it. A lot of women, you're not even like that. You doing that to please this sucker. When his dumb ass, when his pitiful ass, she'll be waiting on you. Whenever you ready, I'm ready. You got all your life to spit out babies. You only have one childhood. You should be able to go out here and date your little boy now and then or whatever. You should not be pressured for no damn sex and enjoy your childhood. But no, these suckers. 13, 14, 15, 18. They ready to pounce on you. And many of you have, you a child and you have a baby, a child. You're not no mother. You're just a young lady that was able to have a baby. You're not no mother. You're a child yourself. What you gonna teach a child? You're a child yourself. These men own you. So here we have a person like Brother Polite, who's bragging about all his wives, not wife. He's bragging about his wives. He has like 3-4 wives and I guess these other children or whatever. But that's not enough. That's not enough for him. He's got to prey on the daughter, which I don't know. I don't think this is his biological daughter. It's probably a, this woman probably already had a young girl child. And this is not the first time. We heard about rumors about Polite way back in the day. They went through this same kind of stuff. He just didn't get caught up about a young girl. But Polite has 4 grown women. But he still finds the need to prey on a 14-year-old. And that's not sick. And people defended this man. We heard the rumors. All these folks defending Polite. Quiet. All those who associated with Polite. He was also, before even that, he was a scammer. They still kept messing with this guy. He was approving. It's people with the receipts. This man ripped me off. Young Pharaoh was one. He sold these fake sovereignty papers to Young Pharaoh. Talk about you can buy your sovereignty because you can be part of this nation that don't exist. And somebody as intelligent as Young Pharaoh gave that man money and it didn't happen. And I think Young Pharaoh supposed to have sued him or whatever. He didn't get nothing. But we know that he was a scammer. And they still kept messing with him. But it don't make no difference as long as you can talk pretty. You charismatic. Sound smart. We eat all that up. And next thing you know, this man is preying on your daughter. We in denial. But see, pedophilia is not nothing old or nothing new, especially when it comes to religion. These pastors and preachers have always done it. And in Islam, they do it. You got people in the Nation of Islam that's in denial that Elijah Muhammad was a pedophile. One of the youngest women we know, one of the youngest women was 15 years old Sister Ola Muhammad. She was 15. They know this. And the rest of them was probably in their 20s, whatever. But you got, this is an old man. Here you are 50. Well, here you are a world leader of an organization. And you're an old man. What is a 20-year-old going to do for you? Except the only thing she could do is spread her legs and pop out babies. That's all those young girls was able to do. They didn't teach him nothing. They didn't do nothing for the organization. That's all they done. The exploitation. Now, when Elijah Muhammad was doing his thing, it was more acceptable. Nobody really tripped off of it. Because I know, now this was the 70s. I grew up in the 1970s. And I graduated out of high school in the 80s. You had college. I was in high school. There was grown men and guys in college hanging around the high school. And those young girls was getting in the cars and going off with these old men and these college guys. Nobody said nothing. And the young girls, well, they didn't like me anyway because I was a nerd. But the young girl was happy to get with the college boys and the old men because they had cars. So me, I got to get on the yellow and black school bus. But they got out of school, went right into a car. And they would take them to the Dairy Queen. They would take them wherever. Because those people had cars. We didn't even have our driver's license yet. And those young girls was happy, proud to have these guys. Because these guys had money. I didn't have a driver's license. I didn't have no money. But it was acceptable. Nobody didn't say nothing. Nobody didn't say, aren't you too old? Now, even for me, I was 17 years old. And I was talking to a young girl. She was 15. I'm 17. She's 15. They told me I was robbing the cradle in the 80s. So look, I'm 17, she's 15, I'm robbing the cradle, and people talk about you robbing the cradle. Oh, but they don't have no problem with Elijah Muhammad, who's 50 years old, messing around with a 15-year-old. Or any of these other suckers that you admire, they the divine of God and all that type of crazy stuff. How come you gonna get on my case? I'm 17 and the young girl 15. I'm robbing the cradle. You got a problem, but you don't have no problem with Elijah Muhammad, almost 60 or 60, messing around with a 20-year-old. What is a 20-year-old? I'm 60 myself. What is a 20-year-old woman going to do for me? What can she do for me? I'm supposed to be her elder. I'm supposed to help guide her, not get in her panties and give her babies. I'm supposed to help guide her through life. I'm supposed to protect her from those who are detrimental to her life. You as a woman, you as a girl, you should be able to live your life because you will be a wife forever. You'll be a mother forever, but you're only going to be a child for a brief period of time. Damn! Let these young girls, let these women have some time. Let them live their life. We ain't going extinct. We have babies in foster care that you can adopt. We don't need to keep having all these, spending out these babies like that. But see, for the black man in America, the reason why we do that is because that's the only way we can feel. like men by using our ding-a-ling, the other head, because we don't know how to use the head on the top and get nothing. So the only way we can feel like a man, how much poutine you claim that you got, how many babies, I got babies in every state. That's the only way that you can feel like a man. But the white man, he can do the same thing, but this is what he'll say. I control that river. See all those skyscrapers, those buildings? I built that. That nuclear power plant? I built that. See all these roads? I built that. What did you build? What can you say?
I got some poutine.
That's the only thing you can say. You have nothing else to add to the conversation. And you don't care about other people's daughter. Don't do it to my daughter. But you willing to do it to somebody's daughter. But don't do it to my daughter. Like Jay-Z. He's probably going to pay for all those years of his nasty talk in those rap songs, and Blue Ivy get pregnant at 17. Get beat up, called a hoe and a bitch. What can he say? You caused it, Jay-Z. I don't want that for my daughter, my wife. Well, you put it out here, they're gonna get it because it's out here and you promoted it. So it's a sick thing. And some of this is acceptable. It's according to who you are. Because it was acceptable for a long time. Because when you hear rumors of that, it might not be true, but at the same time, we need to be wary. But that's Brother Polite. He wouldn't do nothing like that. We don't know what these people, you don't know them personally. We don't know what they would do. You don't know nothing about them. And then we had this sick brother on our channel a few weeks ago talk about if he had a daughter, he would give his daughter to Elijah Muhammad because Elijah Muhammad is divine. How sick. We are some sickos. I heard in the community because of religion, there are some men believe that they should have sex with their daughter before any other man have their daughter. It's some kind of religious garbage. I know there was a rumor in my family because of some kind of religious crap. Seventh-day Adventists or something like they believe in it. I don't know what the religion is, but they're taught that before the daughter can get married to somebody, the father has to try her first. And some of us practice that. There's a lot of pedophilia. There's a lot of incest. There's a lot of sexual molestation in our family. Some of this stuff is kept secret in our family for years and years. And because of our dysfunction and our family, we don't know who is who and what is what. You can mess around and marry your own sister, marry your own brother, and don't even know. Because nobody in the family tells nobody nothing. You don't know your relative. Because I really don't know mine. I'm very wary of women that have the last names of my family members. Because especially if they come from Mississippi or Arkansas or something like that, we might mess around and be related because we don't know. Folks don't tell nobody nothing. I was watching Paternity Court the other day. And there was a case like that. and the young girl was pregnant, and they thought it was a possibility they was brothers and sisters, and good for them, they wasn't. But a lot of us go through that. Some of us do. We don't know. And you find out at the last minute, or you married your cousin, you married a half sister or a half brother or something, because we don't know. But I just want to say for myself, I'm happy that this man, and with all his knowledge, if you notice, now all his knowledge and scholarship, what did he do? This is what I mean by having the appropriate knowledge. All his books, all his reading, all his big mouth, it didn't do nothing to help him in this situation. He had to follow and let his lawyers do his talking with all his knowledge, supreme wisdom, or whatever they call it, didn't help his ass. And see, this is another thing about all y'all sickos that want to be famous, and you want the all these views and subscribers. The same way you go up, you come down. So Brother Polite, after 7 years, he should be done. He should be done. But of course, we sick. There might be some people. I'm going to wait on Polite. I don't believe that stuff. I still don't believe Polite. The man said he was guilty. Oh, that was an FBI, CIA. They did that. That's how we think. But Brother Polite should be done, because after 7 years, and in this community, nobody really want to be affiliated with him like that. And he'd go out into obscurity. So he should enjoy his 15 minutes of fame. But clearly the man is sick, because from where you come from, look where he come from. He come from a terrible place. But a lot of us are sick. We messed up. So you threw all that hard work away. All that away. To mess with a 14-year-old child that trusted you. That trusted you. What is a woman? What is a girl? When she living in an environment and she can't trust her father, her brother, her uncle, the men in her life. What kind of society is that when women can't trust the men in their life? It's sad. I have with me tonight, to continue our talk and bring his opinion about all of this, we have our brother Talib with me on the panel. So I'm going to pass the mic to our brother Talib.
Thanks for allowing me on the panel once again tonight. I would like to say, first of all, that it hurts me to see, you know, that there was a brother who had great potential because of his leadership skills. And those leadership skills was developed as well as influenced by a former so-called leader that I used to claim to follow, whose name is Dr. Malachi Z. York. And that's where Polite got his direct influence from. Mm-hmm. And those of you that know about Dr. Malachi Z. York Hill know that he's sitting in a federal prison with 135 years for something similar as to what Polite is going to prison for. But I just want to point out that, you know, it's a sad day because he could have really been a real positive, influential leader. I mean, he had the leadership quality type skills. That's why people like even Sarnetta allowed him in their circles, because of the quality skills he had as a articulate speaker in the way he expressed himself. And if he could have channeled that into a more positive, sincere direction, ain't no telling where he could have took that. But unfortunately, because of, just like the rest of those in the pro-black conscious community that's all about money, fame, wealth, as we saw at the end with this individual, when he said he was done with the black conscious community and went west on us out to Hollywood. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And what happened? It led from one thing to another. All kind of allegations start hitting at him. Even out there. And then he finally got accused of this crime in Florida of raping this 14-year-old minor. Mm-hmm. So now, unfortunately for him, he has to deal with the consequences behind his actions.
Exactly.
And, you know, it is a part of me, I have to be honest, that's not happy with that. Because he didn't have to go down that road. But I do understand one reason he went down that road. And one thing that I can't empathize with him on is that he was influenced by them wacky ass teachings of Dr. Malachi Z. York, like I was. Okay? Like many of those of us who was a part of his organization was. Okay? So I do empathize with him, though I don't sympathize with him, but I empathize with him. Mm-hmm. You know? And like I said, with his influence and with the skills he had, the technique and the articulation he had about himself, he could have went to bigger and better things far as helping to even liberate other soul people as a whole. But he chose to be greedy like those who claim to be leaders in the pro-black conscious community. Mm-hmm. He became a scammer, a con artist, and all that. Look what his influence did to young brothers like Young Pharaoh. Mm-hmm. If he was honest, he could have helped took Pharaoh, Young Pharaoh, into an honest direction. You know? And I'm going to be honest with you. I pretty much kind of liked the Young Pharaoh when I first started listening to him.
Yeah.
I kind of really took liking to the young brother. I did. I seriously did. You know? And then when I heard that, you know what I'm saying? you know, polite and cats like Sarnetta wasn't doing nothing but using him. Mm-hmm. I said, oh man, that go another waste of potential. And these are elders. And I do fault them for not steering their young brother into the right direction. They weren't going to steer him into the right direction. They should have just left it alone altogether. You know? But they destroyed the potential. Good brother in young Pharaoh.
Yeah.
So, piggybacking off of what the brother just said, I'm glad that this guy who's partly responsible for that as well is about to face the consequences because of a crime he committed against a teenage minor. Mm-hmm. A young sister he was supposed to have been protecting. Yeah. From the rest of the predator wolves. Since her father wasn't there to protect her. Since her mother wasn't there to protect her. And he's supposed to have the supreme wisdom, right? Well, 76 trillion years of knowledge. Or whatever, you know? He's supposed to have all that wisdom. But you took advantage of a young child. Mm-hmm. What type of person with real wisdom like that is going to take advantage of a young child, destroy her physically and emotionally, where she'll be scarred for the rest of her life? That little 7 years he got ain't nothing compared to the rest of her life of being scarred with all that abuse. That's why I say if he would have committed that crime against someone that didn't look like his victim, he'd have got every ounce, nick and cranny of what time he had coming. Along with what he would have had coming if he would have took it to trial. And he knew that. Mm-hmm. That's why he pleaded guilty and didn't take it to trial. Just like his fake ass leader, Dr. Malachi Z. York, pleaded guilty on the state and federal level. Yeah, go look it up. It's all over social media. It wasn't no, just like Sister Nanny said on her live, it wasn't no government trying to take down Malachi Z. York. Mm-hmm. He was already grooming young boys and girls by molesting them way long before that situation happened in Georgia. He was in New York doing that. Come to find out, even when I was being introduced to his teachings in the 80s up there, he was molesting little children. You know what I'm saying? So, I mean, all this crap about the government taking down some these particular type of individuals that black people look to as leaders and all that, you better go back and check their background. That's why I tell people all the time, I say, look, it's your choice to follow whoever you want to follow. It's your choice to believe whatever you want to believe. You a grown man, you a grown woman. But I'm going to say this. You need to study them organizations and these leaders before you join along with them and whatever cause they talking about. You need to study them, investigate them, and especially with the age of social media and the wide world web, you could do that. It ain't like back in the 60s when Elijah Muhammad was peddling that stuff to you about Master Farad Muhammad, or back in the 20s when Noble Drew Ali was coming out with his own brand of Islam, you know, or you had them cats back then like Father Daddy Grace, you know, selling y'all a fantasy dream toward freedom. Nah, you could go online and look these type of people up and find out who they are for real and what background they come from. And that'll be up to you to determine for yourself if that's what you want to follow, if that's what you want to get behind, whether it be an organization or a church or something like that, you know? But you need to understand and realize one thing. And what that one thing you need to realize is always to know it's a probability that you're going to be getting involved in some corruption. More so than something that's supposed to be about positive upliftment for the people, as they claim to be. So this is why I wouldn't wish that even on my worst enemy, to get caught up in this religion or this or these pro-black conscious teachings or ideologies without fact checking first whatever it is before you even get involved in it. Because it's very serious out here now. And these people out here, you understand, ain't nothing but scammers, con artists. They ain't no different than them Negroes in that movie called The Mac.
Mm-hmm.
Or Superfly. Or them other black exploitation movies you used to see back in the 70s. They ain't no different from them kind of people. They just coming in the name of religion. In the name of so-called pro-black consciousness. You know? Like I said yesterday on another live, we did. I done sat up in the church, seen pastors being surrounded by deacons. I ain't talking about the deacon of reality. But by those religious fanatic deacons, you understand? Holding AKs or 4.5s in their hand, ready for somebody to leap like a frog when they seen them money baskets being passed around. You see? All that faith they supposed to have in their so-called God, you got to have a gun to make sure you keep an eye on the money baskets being passed around. You got to put gates and bars up against your doors and windows to make sure don't nobody break in no churches and none of that, right? Hmm. Wow. But you're supposed to have faith and no fear for anything other than in your God, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, it's like this. This is why I say to people, investigate before you join something like that. And I regret it for all them years, even though I'm moving on with my own life, but I regret it getting involved with them teachings of Dr. Malachi York. Because it took quite a bit from me.
Yes.
I could have took that time out of my life and used it for something better. And then who knows behind that where I would be at now, as opposed to where I'm at now, even today in my life. You see what I'm saying? And I don't want to see the next person ever go through that. That's what I'm saying. Because there's many people potentially that's out there for the taking that can end up going through the same thing or even worse. And the way it was back then, I could imagine how worse it is now with these pro-black conscious teachings. They'll probably kill you and make sure nobody hear about it. Like they did with in the case of Malcolm X assassination. They'll make you disappear and won't nobody know nothing about it. See, they got ways of trying to figure that out now without being put under public scrutiny for killing members of their own organizations and stuff like that. You see, so what you need to do is investigate stuff like that now before you get involved. And I'm talking about everybody that's a part of the soul community throughout this country. Or rather to say, since we're not a community, because of the fact that we don't conduct or care ourselves as a community, I'm going to just say simply, people of soul. You know, this is a message to you directly. And I will also say that, you know, from what I heard even on the video, when Nandy posted it on her live show today, earlier, I heard what the judge said. I heard what the prosecutor said. Mm-hmm. And I heard what the lawyer and the defendant himself, who we know, said. So, it's like now, and honestly, 7 years ain't long, but because of the nature of the case, something could happen to him in there. You know, because depending on where you're doing time at, in certain states especially, even like Florida, you know, I mean, some of them guys in there, you know, I mean, people pretty much mind their business in there when it come to other people's cases and stuff and what they doing time for. But in some instances, man, some of them inmates don't care nothing about that. They find out you in there for molesting a minor. You might as well consider your days numbered. Even if you do got an out date. And that's just real. You know, so, I mean, it's like, you know, I hope he make it up out of there alive. But at the same time, I hope he learned his lesson from all this and come out of there. And if he do try to do something positive, I hope he's learned his lesson enough where he'll be more honest about it. Because, and I hope he learned from all this, that being a con and a scam artist ain't gonna get nobody nowhere, including him. You know, so, hey, all I can say is, chicken come home to roots, like somebody once said, you know? He made the bed, and like he made it, that's how he got to lay in it. And so, I mean, it's like, you know, like I say, I kind of feel bad, but at the same time, I don't, because this was a minor. Mm-hmm. And I really feel for the victim. Believe it, I feel for the victim. And I know it's probably nothing I could even say to her, because of her deep emotional hurt and mental pain behind this. But all I can say is I hope for her that she get help much as possible, that her family help her with help, with getting help much as possibly, and that they stand by her much as possibly and help her get through this, so that she can have some type of kind of stable life. You know? Because that's just crazy. You know? This nigga done conned people out of who knows millions of dollars. Hell, I heard he conned people out of thousands, tens of thousands of dollars that he was supposed to have been sending books to. And they never got it.
Yep.
You know, so, I mean, it's like, man, you know, it's like, you know, man, I just, all I can say is, man, is that, you know, when he do get out, because they gave him 10 years, an additional 10 years of probation once he's released from prison. More likely that 7 years since he got probation, I'm thinking they're going to probably just make him max all that 7 years out. You know, and in Florida, they time is set up like the feds. You do 85%. So, I mean, you know, he probably with the nature of them charges and that's in the situation, you know, that's behind this, you know, they gonna probably make him do all them 7 years and just make him max out. And like you say, like the judge told him, get out on probation and give him a chance to mess up again so they can hit him up with them 61 years. Yeah. If he violate, arresting charges carrying 61 years. Should have gave it all to him from the get-go, because like I said earlier, that victim's life is going to be more longer than 7 years worth of his pain. You see what I'm saying? But again, you know, like I said, for him, he got a lot of soul searching to do and a lot of thinking to do.
Yeah.
Because they don't respect child molesters. It's just like they don't respect so-called snitches or whatever. they have nothing for child molesters but blood on their hand. Even to the point where one of them guards could just simply turn their head and after the fact said and done, say, I didn't see nothing. See, that's how them type of places is when you go in there. You thinking you going in there just to do your time? No. You're serving a double possible sentence, which could be death. Mm. And in some cases, it turned out to be that way. You might go in there with what, 2 or 5 years? If you don't end up with 25 of life, you will end up dead. Not making it up out of there. That's why I said, I hope he make it out of there in one piece. Hopefully so he could have a chance to redeem himself. Because every human being makes a mistake. And every human being deserves a chance, depending on what it is. Some cases, we may not have no choice but to let the system handle it. You know what I'm saying? If they don't want those in the what they call community to handle it by taking the law into their own hands. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So, I mean, you know, it's like you know, he got a lot of soul searching to do, and he can't even be walking the yard. If I was him, I wouldn't even be walking the yard, holding conversation with other prisoners. I'd be trying to stay neutral as possible. You see what I'm saying? He might even, it might get that serious for him, because this case is in the news. With all that media attention he got, his case was in the news. Mm-hmm. So you know the word is already out when he hit the yard. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So the best thing for him to do, and I mean, you know, in prison, being on protective custody, you're considered as a weakling or a coward. But that's not in all cases. Everybody that may end up on PC or protection or protective custody ain't always a coward or a punk or a sissy. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. You got some real thoroughbreds on protective custody because it was beyond their own choice of control. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, you know, it's like, but for him, that may be his best interest. I'm serious. And you know, you got a lot of them Caribbean folks doing time down there in Florida, like them Haitians and Jamaicans. And you know, a lot of them Jamaicans come from that Rastafarian ideology, and they not with that child molestation stuff. They known to holler at you behind stuff like that, or ostracize you if you was a part of their community for that type of stuff. So them the type of people he may be around in there, you know? Because you got a lot of people from the Caribbean all throughout Florida. That state is flooded with them. And a lot of them get caught up in that state. I stayed down there for a short period of time. I know. Okay, and like I said, he gonna be around some hellified folks up in there, especially them crazy ass Cubans, you know. And so he, and them brothers up in there, like regular, like American brothers, he gonna have some problems with them too, you know. So his best bet is to figure out why he waiting in the county jail to get shipped off to prison down there. He better figure out what he gonna do. And I'm dead serious. And I'm saying this not so much to, you know, to come at the brother with all kind of shots and stuff. You know, I'm not saying that to aim all kind of shots at the brother, but I'm just saying this out of concern for his safety. Because I know how it is in them type of places. You see what I'm saying? So it's like, it's going to be like, you know, you do, you damn if you don't. And don't, and under them circumstances, especially them kind of circumstances, don't do nothing to piss off no correctional officer or no staff member in there. Because when they show you that they don't like you, oh, you really in trouble up in them type of situations. You see what I'm saying? So, I mean, bro, all I can say is, why he in there? Do a lot of soul searching, even if he got to meditate, and think about clearly what he did, and not only just what he did to get put in there, but think about all the other foolishness he did to other to people. And somewhere down the line, it would hit his conscience hard enough to wake him up and to help him to rise above that. You know? And it's like, man, what Twin Pyramids say, he'll be on the PC yard. Yeah, yeah. That's real talk. Yeah, oh yeah, without a doubt, without a doubt, without a doubt, yeah. Because when you got that type of household name coming into the penitentiary, they definitely gonna be on you. You know, having you to get money put on their books and all kind of stuff. Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah, so yeah, he was some sort of type of celebrity too. After he won Hollywood on everybody, mm-hmm. You know? So I mean, hey, yeah. He might have no other choice but to be on the PC yard after all, you know, with that type of status. You know, but yeah, man, it's a sad day, and it should be a black eye, not only a black eye, which it is, but it should be a sad day for the black conscious community, because all them lies, like someone said on their channel, that they was telling over there on Sarnetta's panel, they try to make people believe that Polite wasn't guilty. Huh. You know? When even Sarnetta was seen saying that Polite admitted out of his own mouth, you understand, that he was guilty. So he admitted it out of his own mouth, you know, while Sarnetta trying to say it, that's not the narrative. Wait a minute. The man said out of his own mouth that he raped, tortured, and abused this woman. You see what I'm saying? No one forced him to do that. He could have said, hell, I'm not guilty. Let's take this to trial.
Exactly.
Simple as that. And there's some people that be guilty as hell and will still take chances of taking it to trial. And in some cases, actually beating it at a 12 jury trial because of insufficient circumstantial evidence. You see what I'm saying? So he could have took his chances and wiggled that dice, you know, to try to fight it at the 12 bench jury trial. You know what I'm saying? To try to fight it in the 12 jury trial case, but he would have got found guilty because it was too much evidence. But I mean, he could have made the choice to take that to trial. I mean, you know, if you ain't guilty, why plead guilty anyway? So obviously, he felt the pressure coming down like a pipe finna bust. And he said, no, I'm gonna plead guilty. And that's what happened. You know, so, I mean, hey, all of those to you, and big ups to my soul sister, our soul sister, Nandy, on her, and big ups to her channel, because she's been covering this a whole lot, even before the day when he was sentenced to them 7 years and 10 years probation. She's been covering all this situation all alone. Fogs would be going on in the black conscious community, especially with all this pedophilia behavior and stuff going on with minors. So I say once again, I salute and give her big ups for that. You know? And it's just a sad day. It really is. And most of the people I don't see on in them black conscious social media channels even covering that. Not too many of them are covering that. But they'd be willing to get on there and debate and talk about a bunch of bull crap that has no sufficient relevancy to anything, but just BS itself. You know? But, you know, I heard they was under one of Sarnetta's live pages talking crazy in the comment section or whatever, but they was basically mad, like somebody said, because they knew how stupid they looked trying to defend the behaviors of Polite. Now they looking stupid. They don't know what to say. They don't even know how to come with any type of defense now when somebody addressed them with it. Because the man said it himself.
That's right.
You know? The man said it himself. He said he was guilty of child pedophilia. Did nobody pick up nothing and bust him in the head and tell him, nah, this is what you say? Out of his own free will, he said it out of his own mouth. And that's what all everybody needs to understand. You know? So, you know, man, it's like, damn. You know, I just don't understand it, man. You know, and basically what y'all heard earlier on this live podcast, it was enough already said that I don't really need to even continue this conversation because it's sad. It really is sad. And matter of fact, since Dr. Malachi Z. York Hill went to prison for the same thing, you know, now, like somebody said, polite has been put in front of him. You know, as being added along the list of those in the pro-black conscious community that's been in jail or finna go to jail over child pedophilia or molestation. You see what I'm saying? So it's like, and I haven't heard about him in the last couple few years, but Prince York, who's supposed to be the youngest son of Dr. Malachi Z. York, was hit up with similar allegations. So you got to remember, they coming from the same influence under the teachings of Dr. Malachi Z. York. And so once again, this is another case added on with the corruption and, you know, abuse, rape, molestation, and scamming of those who you say you love as black people. You can't love black people with that type of mentality or with that type of distorted heart when you don't even love your own self. So how can you say you love other black people? Let alone you saying you love all black people, which those of us who got more sense than that know that that's a lie, you know. But how can you say you love black people with this type of mentality and you don't love yourself? Like polite. He's a prime example now. He's on his way to prison. You ain't got no love for yourself like that. Putting yourself in a position to go to prison over something you intently did and knew what you was doing when you did it. You don't love yourself. So once again, you don't love yourself. How can you love other black people as you claim? And that's part of my message to the so-called black conscious community. Just like when that guy RZA Islam, I heard he got off. Heard they dropped them charges against him for fraud, scamming people and all that kind of stuff. Through Medicaid and all that other crap he was doing. You know? And who knows, he still may be guilty, but maybe the courts didn't have enough evidence to prove it. But we know some people who were involved with him, including his mother, ended up going to prison during time. But for them shenanigans that was going on with him. But somehow he happened to get from under and everybody else had to bite the bullet, right? I'm just saying, you know. So it's like, man, I just, you know, this is the reason why, family, you know, this is the reason why I'm so disappointed with soul people. I really am. Because we could do a whole lot better than what we're doing. We're not holding our leadership accountable. And this is why stuff like this goes on. Because polite, like Sarnetta, like these other people claim that they're leaders and teachers. You know? Now, with the help of people in black social media, some more of these people that come from the same circles of polite is about to get exposed and possibly end up having to face legal consequences like him. Because I'm going to tell you something. Even though he got caught doing what he did, but I'm going to tell you what brought this situation to this point. Because some people in black social media started calling him out a long time ago, especially after they saw the fakery that was going on with him and Sarnetta and how they did Young Pharaoh. If you notice, Sara Sue Seti stepped away from them. A brother I seen personally, he's from the same hometown I'm from. And for somehow, some reason, this brother, which I got to give him credit for, was able to step away from that situation. That's why you don't hear his name. You know? And now they starting to say Sarnetta might have had something to do with some of that stuff in Florida that Polite was doing. So, like I said, if I was somebody, I would keep my mouth shut on that subject particularly. Because it might be more people that could go to jail over this. Because this might not be over from the looks of it. It just might not be over. But we'll see. And that's why it's important for people just in certain cases just to keep their mouth shut. Because, you know, them folks might be seeing them next. Knocking at their door talking about they got a warrant in Dade County, Florida somewhere. Or wherever that case was in Florida. You know? And, I mean, it's like, man. I think it was in Broward County. If I remember hearing it when it first happened. That's right outside of Dade County. But, yeah, way down there in the southeastern part of Florida. But, I mean, man, you know, it's sickening. It really is. And it's like, at this point, further, on that note, I'm at a loss of words. But I'm sorry for the victim. Because the victim is the most important person in this situation. Despite all the other stuff. And with that said, I'm going to gracefully bow out and yield the mic back to our brother.
All right. Well, I would like to say this in closing. Unlike some folks, I don't wish harm. I don't wish ill. I don't hate. I'm not jealous. I'm not envious. I don't wish death on people. I don't wish bad luck on people. I don't do that. In fact, I concur with you, Brother Talib, when you said, what a waste, you know, of talent. And this is what I told Brother City years ago.
Right.
In St. Louis, and we had a brief talk. And, you know, at that time, I made a lot of videos about City. I told SETI, I don't mean nobody any harm, but I see you greater than what you see yourself. I see you doing way more than what you're doing. You know, this is tiddlywinks, you know, little stuff that you're doing. I mean, it's nice, but you can do a whole lot more. Even Minister Louis Farrakhan, they look at him like he's great. Actually, he could be a lot greater. But we put ourselves in these boxes and we hinder our own progress. We can't see outside of we get caught up in these boxes, this thinking. And then it gets to the point where we begin to believe our own hype. Man, I am great. I am this, I am that. That's one of the reasons why our poor brother Michael Jackson is not here, because he was surrounded by yes people. Yes, Michael. You right, Michael. Yes, Michael. Yes, Michael. Those doctors should have never gave him that propofol. Never. Shouldn't have got him started on that, but they're getting paid plus, you know. Yes, Michael. Yes, Michael. And Michael had problems with his family because they could see that he was changing. He didn't want to hear it. And he didn't want to be around family members no more. Janet and some of the other members saw this, what was going on. They tried, but you can't help nobody. You cannot help nobody who don't want to help themselves. He's surrounded by those who would do his bidding, and it cost him his life. I'm very sure there was people around Polite that tried to tell him. He got rid of those people. You get rid of the ones that don't get on your, you know, get with your program. You get rid of them. Farrakhan is surrounded by yes people. He's not going to want to be around people that really say something to put him in check, to help him. They're not doing nothing to hurt you. They're trying to help you. But we can't see that because they get to a point where they believe their own hype. I'm great. I'm the this. And some people think that Louis Farrakhan has had a wonderful life. No, he has not. He has not. I can guarantee you he has not. I wouldn't be shocked that there was times that he looked and cried. But you can't tell nobody nothing. I would not wish jail on nobody. You know, I haven't been to prison, but I've been locked up for 10 years. So I wouldn't wish that on nobody. That's not a wonderful place to be, being locked up. That's not. But it's inevitable. Unfortunately, you know, he brought this down on himself because you can't tell nobody nothing. We suffer right now as a people because we can't. Nobody can't tell us nothing. We know it all. Can't tell me nothing. And we do it even in our own personal lives. We surround ourselves by people, our yes people. Yes to live. Yeah, you can do that. Yes to live. Yeah, to live. Yeah. And you're not going to get nowhere. We need somebody to keep us what they call grounded. And a lot of celebrities who keep people around them that's real with them, keep them grounded, they do pretty well, even in the celebrity world. Because there's somebody there, your mother, whatever. Look, I don't care who you are. I don't care how many millions of dollars. You come over here, I whoop your ass. I don't care about all that. You know, you don't run nothing here. We need people to keep us grounded. We need people. You don't want to hear it, but if you want to survive, you want to do the best that you can. You have to have people, surround yourself with people that will keep it real with you. And I know there are those who don't like Angel Snub 07, and that's for the very reason, because I keep it too real. and they want to be surrounded by people, yes, people. That's why we can't get nowhere as people, because nobody can tell us anything. It's a sad situation today. It's sad for Brother Polite, and it's sad for the young lady. And on that note, we've said all that we need to say. And like Brother Talib said, maybe after 7 years, you might see a brand new person. And maybe if he's that brand new person and people can see him as this brand new person, even though he's gone through all this, maybe it took this, when this brand new person come out of prison after 7 years, maybe he might be the one. Because he's still a young person. How old is Brother Polite?
I'm not for sure.
Because you know, when we first heard of Brother Polite, he was, they used to call him the young phenomenon or something like that. Phenom.
Oh, okay. I think I remember that. Hearing them say that on Sarnetta's platform. I do think I remember that. Yeah, I remember hearing that. Yeah. The young phenomenon. Wow.
Yeah. He was a young person. But you know, as a lot of time has gone by, he ain't no Mr. Young no more.
Well, you know, Sarnetta was born in the 60s like we was. So yeah, for him to call, so
I think he's 62, something like that.
Right, because for him to refer to Polite as a young phenomenon, Polite must have had to be born somewhere in the late 70s or something like that, you know?
But Kermit said he's 40.
40, yep, well, he's born in the late, somewhere around the late 70s. If he 40, if he, wait a minute, if he 40, 81. Yeah, 40, 81, yeah, so he's a product of the early 80s then.
Yeah. Because Beyonce just turned 40.
Okay, yeah, so he's a product of the early 80s.
Yeah, 1983.
So he still, so he got time. Yeah. Oh, that's the year he was born?
Yeah, 1983.
Oh, okay. You must have looked him up on Wikipedia or something, because usually they got that kind of. Oh, okay. Okay. All right.
You know, I remember when Beyonce was 17, 18 years old.
Right.
And now she's 40. She's 40 now. Like, wow, all the time gone by so quick. But, you know, those guys, Sarnetta and all those guys was bad examples for them, because they, you know, Polite, and there was, you probably don't remember him, but there was another brother that was trying to come up with them too. Remember brother, they used to call him Young Marcus?
Yeah.
Matter of fact, it was Polite, Young Marcus, and Young Fur. All of them was coming up around the same type of time. And I don't know what happened to Young Marcus. I guess he couldn't, you know, the reality of, he didn't get caught up in that thing. But like I said, I admire all of them. You know, all our people who's out here that's teaching and doing whatever. I admire all of them, but also at the same time, they must understand that you're not perfect. You don't carry no supreme wisdom. You got flaws and errors in your teachings. And they don't want to accept that. You know, surround me by yes people. And somewhere, I guess the money and all that got the Brother Polite. And he went to Hollywood and got caught up in all that mess. Chances are he was doing drugs. Because when you get caught up in all that partying stuff, you know, they do drugs. Drink a lot of alcohol, do drugs. That's all they do. You know, partying around people. He got caught up in all like that. But apparently he has some kind of sickness going on anyway, because why would he be attracted to his, that would be his stepdaughter. If that's his so-called wife, which she's not really a wife, then, you know, they're not legally married or nothing like that. But let's just say you say that this woman is your wife and you're going to molest your stepdaughter. You know, he got some kind of sickness. And again, this is all that we know. We don't know about what we don't know. And the rumors about this man has been going on for a little while. But now got caught up like R. Kelly. You know, R. Kelly kept doing what he got away with that stuff the first time. Just kept doing it. Kept doing his thizzy and got caught up. Polite got caught up. But again, he's 40 years old. I don't know what's going to happen during the time that he's in prison. He might do well. It's not like Polite knows about jail. He knows about prison. That's not my deal. He knows how. He knows what the deal is. But maybe, like you said, maybe this is his transformation. A transformation for the better. I was talking about for every dark cloud, there's a silver lining. Maybe this is his silver lining. It's not as dark as we think that it is. We don't know. I hope that, because sometimes bad things happen so the best things can come forth. I want to thank everybody for joining us tonight and listening to our discussion of this sad situation, because it's a sad situation, because there are no winners. There's no winners in this type of predicament. But hopefully there is a silver lining in the cloud. I want to thank, haven't seen Z-Mad in a while. I want to thank Z-Mad for stopping by. Of course, the Deacon's Reality, Mellow Cap, all our people. Well, Brother Talib is here, so I don't have to say your name. Shout out to Sister Ann, Tafari Smith, Angela Hines, Brother Denzel, Phil Fox, Brother Stephen, Christopher Steffens, and Sean. It's not that many of us, so I should be able to remember everybody. I think I got everybody.
So Sister Tangie Cox.
Yeah. They laid her mother to rest today. I saw the video. They
put her okay.
So, you know, again, condolences to Sister Tangie going through that, but they buried yes. her. They buried the mother today.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so always send condolences to Sister Tangie out there and family. Also, shout out to our people in London, England, the Just Acting and the Resident. All those who listen to us. And, you know, I don't try to bring harm to nobody. I wish everybody success. But sometimes we need to get, you know, we need to get our shirt tugged. We need a reality check. And that's what this platform is about. It's a reality check. It's not about putting down your ideology or your beliefs or anything like that, but you need a reality check. You need to revise what you're doing, or I would suggest that we just start brand new. I think that starting brand new is much better. It's much better. So then trying to revise. And there are those who can do that. You need a revision. You need to see things in a more realistic manner. You need to bring what you have to 2023. We can't continue to live in 1930 and 19. We can't continue to depend on, like, we can communicate and wonder what dead people can do. We can't do those. You have to be yourself. That's why you have to open up your own mind and guide yourself. You have to become, like we said, the MACD. So on that note, because time is not guaranteed to nobody, if we see each other again, I hope that we can come here and talk about something else that is positive and beneficial to us. I really don't like negative things, especially this campaign that we have is called The Healing, and trying to do our best to try to stay positive. Unfortunately, we do live in a world where there are those who will break your peace for whatever reason. But we're going to do the best that we can in order to heal and continue to try to be as positive. One of the first steps in order to build a nation or all these things that we talk about, the first step is to heal yourself. The first step is to make a better human being. Because to make a better human being, a better person, all other things will fall in place. But as long as you're dirty, as long as you're filthy, as long as you're raggedy, that's all you can produce. Like I heard Minister Farrakhan say, you're living in hell because you're a devil. That's all you can do. Devilish things, because you're a devil. When you become an angel, you will begin to produce angelic things. You will produce heaven on earth, like the scriptures say. The scriptures say that heaven is on earth. The scriptures say that the kingdom of heaven is in you. It's all on us.
Hey, did you mention our brother Denzel?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, I want to say shout out.
Yeah. Shout out to Brother Khalil too.
Oh yeah, shout out to our brother Khalil as well. Yes.
Yeah. And shout out to the cool man. Come a little bit late here with his question. Because we're getting ready. I'm ready to get out of here. So thank you, Brother Khalil, for joining me on this live stream.
All right. And send me. Yes, sir. And send me that. Right. And send me that video afterwards, because the other one you sent me from last night, it went on and then it popped up and said it was a private video. So send this one to me quickly.
I put the channel on. I had to hide the channel because, you know, my channels keep getting flagged.
Oh, okay. Okay. So all right.
Take the channel offline. I might do it. I might do the same thing with this one. Take it offline.
Okay. Right. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sometimes you got to do that.
Yeah.
Go through all that crap. Right. Right.
Yeah. You know, Tahaka Bay flagged this channel here.
Oh, yeah. Oh, really?
Yeah. He flagged.
Oh man!
A video. I was the guest. How you gonna flag a video? I'm the guest. I'm on the panel. But that's how low. With all his supreme wisdom and knowledge and understanding, that's how low he's fallen.
I'm telling you, man. I have to be honest, but I'm starting to believe with other. The stuff that other people be spoiling about him, because he has become suspect as far as being fake, like that situation with him and Malik Shabazz.
Uh-huh.
And I'm going to just leave it as that, you know, because everybody throughout social media and in the so-called black conscious community know what that situation is with him and Malik Shabazz.
Mm-hmm.
And it was about him scamming just to get money. So, you know, I got to the point I don't even go on that guy's page no more. And I really don't trust him.
Yeah.
With his fake voice, American ass.
Yeah, all of them are caught up. See, there was a time when YouTube did not allow you to even ask for money on their platform. You couldn't even ask for a donation, right, or nothing like that. Then they turn around and monetize. And that's when these people really, really went crazy.
Yeah.
Because if you get enough views, you really can make some money on YouTube.
Right.
And they all sell outs. They all sell outs.
Oh, man, and social media.
You know, YouTube is not going to bother them because they're not no threat.
Right.
They're not no threat. They're not saying anything. They're not saying anything that can really do nothing for the listening audience. They're not saying or doing anything. It's just, you know, it's some more docile, feel-good church stuff. That's all it is. It's nothing but like going to church, you know. But
I'm going to say this. YouTube bought out. Right. YouTube bought out the fakeness in people in this era. Just like people was able to detect the fake in other ways. Like when you only had word of mouth to go around or reading something through a book. Well, YouTube really allow the fake to really expose itself even more at all time levels. And this is why through social media, through the age of social media, people really know who everybody is and what they're about because of the exposure through social media. Mm-hmm. A lot of stuff that we know even about people like Elijah Muhammad and Noble Drew Ali and Marcus Garvey, we wouldn't have known about had it not been for social media. So with these guys like the Harker Bay, you know, you know, he just exposed himself. He talking about all these other people like Malik Shabazz. And this one brother in the Nation of Islam that's supposed to follow Silas Muhammad, right? He even came down on him trying to expose him as some type of agent. But he, like they say in Orthodox Islam, when you talk like that about other people, you could be pointing three fingers at yourself. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying, you know, he's definitely showed what I'm saying is he showed his left hand. In many ways, many more ways than one, he didn't show his left hand. So I really, you know, if he can't benefit off you, he's a type like this. If he can't benefit off you, he won't even have nothing to do with you. He won't even respond to your questions in the comment section under his videos. You know, that's the type of person he is, you know. If you don't bring no real tangible benefit personally, far as he concerned, he don't got nothing to do with you. Mm-hmm. And because you didn't agree with his shenanigans, especially when y'all had y'all little debate, that's probably why he had your channel took down. Mm-hmm. Ain't no telling. Because that guy been suspect, and you also know he's been accused for child molestation, although he wasn't convicted. Mm-hmm. But they've shown receipts where it was complaints made against him officially to the police about abusing young minors. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
So I mean, this is another case of what we see going on in the pro-black conscious community, you know. And I mean, you know, so it's like, man, it is what it is, you know. And
he told me that he's supposed to be turning his channel around, no more beef videos, or whatever. He's gonna concentrate on his teachings, and he's gonna concentrate on positive things. Like he's supposed to be building some kind of homeless shelter or something for the homeless in Baltimore. And he was making videos showing that he was rehabbing houses and all this kind of good stuff. You know, to my knowledge, he's not even doing that no more. He's on this attack Tariq Nasheed kick,
He done made more videos about Tariq Nasheed than anything.
Wow.
And I think Tariq Nasheed just decided just to ignore him. He, you know, he going about his business. He don't even
right. respond. Well, after we saw what happened with Malik Shabazz, everybody knew that wasn't going nowhere anyway. Because mm-hmm. eventually, what he was going to try to do was get Tariq Nasheed sucked into something just to find justification to try to use a way to defraud him, you know? Exactly. Like with the case with Malik Shabazz. So, you know. And
all
I heard
these,
when he went...
guys is questionable. All of them are.
Oh yeah, definitely. And this nigga, and how did he get money to fly all the way to California? he's supposed to go, been going to what he was supposed to been going to California to do? To confront Malik Shabazz or something?
No, he went to confront Tariq Nasheed.
Yeah, okay, yeah. Tariq Nasheed, yeah.
Tariq Nasheed slapped him in the face. you didn't see that?
I didn't see the video. I think they showed it, but I don't remember seeing it. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, the security camera caught it, and when Tariq slapped him in the face. I mean, that's so stupid. You know, that's just like me. The way I talk about Farrakhan, and I know these people don't like how I talk about the Nation of Islam. That's just like me going to Mas Marion. You know, these people, you know, what you think going to happen to me?
Right.
You know, and he flew all the way 2,000 miles to Los Angeles. And then he went to that other event, Tariq Nasheed had this reparations thing, convention thing, some kind of march or something going on. He went there just to, you know, mess with the people, you know, to try, you know, put what was going on down and all like that, whatever. You know, he almost got into some problem with that because them people wouldn't, you know, don't come here messing our stuff up. Take your happy ass on somewhere. I mean, what are you doing? Show us that rehab homeless shelter, whatever. That, what are you doing? Show us what you doing.
Right.
you and all your people running your damn mouth, if y'all actually was doing something, but have no time to be messing with Tariq Nasheed.
Mm-hmm.
Show him how it's done. I mean, you got all these subscribers. What he got? 27, 30,000 subscribers, whatever. You know, yeah. You got $5 from every one of them. You could do some stuff with it. Go show us what show Tariq Nasheed what he need to be doing.
say Tariq Nasheed slapped the taste out of him, huh?
Yeah, the cool man said Tahaka looked like he was gonna cry after he got slapped. It's really pathetic. I mean, what? I don't understand the logic behind that.
Wow.
You're gonna fly
all the way to another side of the country 2,000 miles to get slapped in the face. Damn.
Yeah, because I mean, what are you doing? You're going there to bother this man. You know he don't like you. You're not going there right. to try to be his brother and try to, you know, work something out in person or anything like that. You're going there to bother this man. And Tariq slapped him.
Huh. Wow.
You know, Tariq ain't nothing to play with. Tariq was slapped you because, you know, he did it to, what's his name, Tommy Sotomayor? He caught Sotomayor. Mm. Yeah.
Wow.
Tariq is about what, like 6'1", 6'3", or something like that? He probably weighed
300. Right.
And people be talking about Tariq, you know, Tariq came from gang lifestyle.
Yeah.
You know, so he ain't no chump like that.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Know what he's doing now, you know, but that's his background. You know, he grew up in you know, you know, he grew up in a violent environment. You know, he didn't come up. He ain't no, you know, pretty boy like you know like he is now. You know,
right.
But that's another thing. See, we don't know what might happen to Brother Polite. This he might be going through the transformation.
Right.
He might be a brand new Polite, you know. And if people recognize that he's changed and he's different, maybe he can, all the harm that he caused, maybe he can finally, he can come back and bring good.
One last thing I'm going to say about that, piggybacking off what you said. I hope, like I said before, I hope he do change. And yeah. I look toward the best for him from this point on.
Yeah.
Because I've been in his shoes. As far as where he headed to. And so for him, nothing but the best could come out of this.
Yeah. There's no winners in all this. It's like we said, it's a sad, the whole thing is just a sad situation. You know,
yeah, it is. It really is. I just, you know.
There's no winners, no. You know, be happy or whatever. It's just
no. There's no winners so in this. Because you got wasted potential, and you got a life destroyed mentally and emotionally and physically.
Yeah.
So, like you said, brother, which I concur with, there's no winners in this.
No.
Say what happened to
wives?
To his wives, huh?
You know, he's supposed to have
that's all, a good all question. His wives. You know, he had I remember he was supposed to have concubines or something.
Yeah, you know, like three or four.
Yeah.
Used to make videos with all of him and all, you know, the whole family. Used to make videos with all of them. Yeah, but he something when he went to Hollywood, something for real, you know, changed him. It was a sister, I'm going to say this, we need to get out of here. But it was a sister that said she was trying to work with Polite, and she was saying that all that in Hollywood was an illusion. They was riding the bus, the house wasn't big enough, and they was renting. You know, it was all illusion. It wasn't real.
All those cars they were supposed to have been living in a house?
No, a mansion.
Okay.
She said the house was not big enough for him and all those women and children. You know, they were squeezing his house. Those cars that he got was not his, of course. You know, they was rental. Matter of fact, even some rappers do it. You know, they rent those high-priced cars. It was all illusion. You know, make yourself more than what you really are. And if you got enough money to pull that off, you know, you can fool people that do have money. You know, they don't know that expensive car is rented. And you know, you live in this big old house. They don't know that it's rented. You can say that they don't know. But anyway, he has to deal with reality. Now all that fantasy stuff is over. Getting ready to deal with for real reality now. All that illusion and playing games is over.
I wonder how did he end up in Florida? What he must have, everything that he had going in California must have fell through the roof or something.
Who knows? So I guess those wives went silent too. They went silent. I haven't heard nobody say anything about all those wives and. Because what did the other wives, because I never heard what the other wives had to say about the charges, you know, when all that first kicked off.
Right.
So, well.
And then he went from New York to California, from California to Florida.
Yeah.
That's full circle there.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah,
but I do know if our so-called leadership, these people keep following these personalities, and and these incompetent leadership, they ain't gonna go nowhere. You know, it's nothing but, this is not revolutionary talk. This is nothing but church.
Right.
Because revolutionary talk, it comes down to two things, like Malcolm said, the ballot or the bullet.
Exactly.
A lot of these people talk about they revolutionaries or whatever, and they make mockery of the ballot, but right. I don't see you picking up no bullets.
Exactly.
And even Malcolm,
and I don't see you picking up guns toward the right people.
No, you sure not, because they know what they're gonna get.
Right.
They know what they're gonna get messing with these people.
Exactly.
And they won't stop till all of you are dead or in prison.
Exactly.
Because you mess with them, you might as well be that's a suicide. You know,
yeah.
A suicide pact.
Especially when you ain't got no strong defense against it like that.
Exactly. You know, but they running their mouth like they're tough. You're not tough.
Right. No, you're not.
You're only tough to these other little Negroes that ain't going to do nothing like you. You know, yeah, you'll jump on another black man, another person, but the real enemy, you're not going to mess with these people.
Nah. You know? And I know we got to go, brother, but this is what kills me about these Negroes. You real tough. You real cocky and tough with each other, but when it comes to these other folks, you soft as jello.
Yeah.
You real soft as jello.
Because you know, there ain't no game. These folks gonna bring the heat. You don't want most of these folks don't want to do that. Well, we already know the white boy gonna bring the heat, and these Mexicans.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Even some of these Africans and stuff, you mess with them, they bringing the heat.
Yeah. That's real. That's real.
With the Mexican gangs in LA,
You talking about the MS-13, the Mexican mafia and all that? Yeah.
They said the Crips and the Bloods scared of them.
Yeah, that's what I heard. Yep. Yep, 1,000% fact. Yeah. That's what I heard. Matter of fact, I heard they even scared of them in prison. Mm. They won't even step to them hard in prison. Nor on the streets. That's why they ran a lot of the Crips and Bloods out of Compton. They ran a lot of them Crips out of Compton.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Mexicans. They took over Compton.
They used to mess with folks that don't really, you know, come hard like that. These people come hard.
Yeah.
I mean, they come, it's no joke for them. They come and come hard. You know, and we don't have that war. We keep talking about we're God and warrior. You don't have that warrior type spirit. They don't have it. You know, you got a big ass mouth. But when it come down to the nitty gritty, they ain't ready for that kind of action.
Yeah.
Not ready.
Oh yeah.
So on that note, we gonna roll on out of here, and thank you, brother Talib, for joining me tonight.
Yes, sir. To
discuss this this breaking news, and again, maybe some good will come out of it when it's all said and done.
Right.
That's what I'm hoping for.
I hope I'm right.
Yeah, I hope that I can live to see it. It's 7 years. Maybe I can make it.
All right. All right, brother. I'm out of here. Peace. Hey, send me the link as soon as you get off.